Yeah, now I'm playing.
No, the videos you are recording every day that you are posting on your same YouTube channel.
Yeah, same YouTube channel you can find. Yesterday I uploaded the same.
Okay, sir, thank you.
Okay, right. Can you see the video?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah,
yes, sir.
Just
Yes,
go through. It's 2 minutes.
A reciprocating compressor compresses refrigerant vapor in a cylinder using a piston. In a way, reciprocating compressors are like automobile engines. The pistons are directly driven through a wrist pin and connecting rod from a crankshaft. Depending on their size, reciprocating compressors may have one or more cylinders. Multiple cylinders may be arranged in line, opposed, or in a V. In each cylinder, reciprocating compressors have both a suction valve and a discharge valve. These valves give the compressor its ability to pump refrigerant vapor against a pressure difference. They are usually located in the head of the cylinder, in passages connected to the high or low pressure side of the system. Let's follow the compression process in a single cylinder reciprocating compressor during one complete revolution of the crankshaft. Starting with the piston at the top of its stroke, or at top dead center, the piston begins to move downward as the crankshaft rotates. Because both valves are closed, the downward moving piston reduces the pressure in the cylinder. As the pressure in the cylinder falls below the low side pressure in the suction line, the pressure difference opens the suction valve, letting refrigerant vapor flow into the cylinder. The piston continues down and pulls in more vapor until the cylinder is filled with low pressure vapor at the bottom of its stroke. Once past bottom dead center, the piston begins its upward stroke. The suction valve closes. As the piston moves up, it reduces the volume of the space in the cylinder, increasing the pressure of the vapor. When the pressure in the cylinder exceeds the high side pressure in the discharge line, the pressure difference pushes the discharge valve open, letting the compressed vapor flow out of the cylinder. This continues until the piston reaches the top of its stroke and most of the compressed vapor has been expelled into the discharge line. When the piston begins its downward stroke, the discharge valve closes. The complete cycle then repeats during each revolution of the crankshaft. This is the mechanical positive displacement vapor compression cycle using a reciprocating compressor.
Right. Is it is clear? Working? The same thing I discussed yesterday. How the suction is taking place, right? So when the piston is moving top dead center to bottom dead center, first vacuum is created. So due to the pressure difference, outside the air compressor, the pressure is atmosphere. Inside the air compressor, the pressure is below the atmosphere. Therefore, the suction valve opens. Therefore, the air from the atmosphere will enter into the air compressor. And during the return stroke of the piston, the air present inside the cylinder will be compressed, right? So thereby the pressure is increased and thereby the discharge starts. This is about the working of the air compressor. Any doubt in this one? Please tell me. Students?
No, sir.
No, right. Now today we will discuss, as we know, the compressor is a work consuming device because in order to increase the pressure, and in order to decrease the volume of the air, we need to supply some external power or work to the compressor. Now today we will see what is the amount of work required to compress the air, right? So in order to understand this concept, you should know the concepts of thermodynamics, that is the work done during different types of process. Okay. Now let me quickly recall. So what are the different types of processes we studied in thermodynamics? We studied about constant pressure process, constant volume process, constant temperature process, and constant entropy process. Then adiabatic process. And finally, we discussed polytropic. Right. So here I required at least the work done during adiabatic process, polytropic process, and constant temperature process. Okay, so let me quickly recall, right? So in case of isothermal process, constant temperature process, so let me draw PV and TS diagrams. PV and TS diagram. In TS diagram, constant temperature is represented by a horizontal line. What about PV diagram?
Hyperbolic.
Yeah, hyperbolic process. Hyperbolic. We can call it as a hyperbolic process. How to draw in PV diagram? Constant temperature line. Right. Right. This is the constant temperature. Here in TS diagram, it is a horizontal line. So it is a horizontal. It's not inclined one. It is a horizontal line. Okay. Now let us say state one, state two. Let us assume this is the expansion process. 1, 2, 2. Okay, so from first law of thermodynamics, we know W is equals to integral P into dV. Okay, W equal to integral P into dV. And for isothermal process, for T is equals to constant, so I can write PV is equals to constant. So therefore, P I can written as C by V, where C is the constant. Okay, so therefore, W is equals to integral C by V dV. P is nothing but C by V, where C is the constant. I can write 1 by V dV. So that is equal to C into log V. 1 by X dx is log X. Okay. So between the limits 1, 2 to state 1, 2, 2, where C can be written as PV log V2 by V1 base E. So this is the work done during isothermal process. This is also written as PV ln V2 by V1. Is it is clear? We already discussed in last semester, just recalling. This is the work done during the isothermal process. If you are having any doubts, you can refer my previous videos. It will be more clear. Right, next we will go to quickly. Anyone I can discuss either adiabatic or polytropic process, because if the governing equation is PV power gamma equals constant, if the compression or expansion following according to the law PV power gamma equals constant, I can call it as adiabatic process. If it follows according to the law PV power n equal to constant, I can call it as polytropic process. The only difference is the only index is different. Remaining process is same. Okay, right. So let us consider, we'll discuss for polytropic process. Now I'm going to derive the work done during polytropic process, right? So again, as usual, draw PVTS diagrams, PV diagram, and TS diagram, okay? Right, so in TS diagram, if it is isothermal process, I can draw horizontal line. If it is isentropic process, I can draw vertical line. So this is S is equals to constant, and this is T is equals to constant. Whereas coming to polytropic process, it is in between T and S. Therefore, this is the PV power N is equals to constant. PV power N equal to constant. And this will be sim 1, 2, 2. This is the polytropic expansion process. So therefore here, PV power N is equals to constant. So therefore, the P is equals to C by V power N. I can write V power minus N into C. Okay, and we know basic equation W equals to integral P into dV, integral V power minus N into C into dV, where C is the constant, keep it outside of the integration, and V power minus N dV. So that is equals to C into, let me minimize this, right, C into V power X power N dx, X power N plus 1 by N plus 1, in the same way, V power minus N plus 1 divided by minus N plus 1 between the limit state 1, 2, 2. Okay, so where C can be written as PV power N. I can write either P1 V1 power N or P2 V2 power N. Let us say P1 V, let it be C only. Now we'll see later. C into 1 minus N is a constant. I can write outside of the integration. V2 power 1 minus N minus V1 power 1 minus N. Okay. So now substitute C value. I'm taking C as P2 V2 power N for the first term and C as P1 V1 power N for the second term. Therefore, work done is equals to 1 by 1 minus N is the constant. First term, I'm multiplying C with P2 V2 power N into V2 power 1 minus N minus second term, I'm taking P1 V1 power N into V1 power 1 minus N. If you see here, V2, V2, when bases are same, I can add the powers. In the same way, here also when bases are same, I can add the powers. Therefore, 1 by 1 minus n into, so P2, so minus n plus n will be cancelled, P2 V2 minus, here also n n will be cancelled, P1 V1. So therefore, work done during polytropic process is equals to P2 V2 minus P1 V1 by 1 minus n. 1 minus n, right? So here I can also written as P1 V1 minus P2 V2 by 1 minus n. Just multiplying with minus so that I can change. Sorry, n minus 1, sorry. Yeah, this is n minus 1. Is it is clear?
Yes, sir.
If it is adiabatic process, if it is adiabatic process, n is replaced by gamma. Remaining everything is gamma. Same. P1 V1 minus P2 V2 by gamma minus 1, right? Na? Right. So this is the work derived or delivered by which process? So what is happening 1, 2, 2 here? What happens to the pressure and what happens to the volume? Look at the board. What is
pressure
happening?
Pressure decreasing, volume increasing.
Increasing means this is expansion or compression process?
Expansion.
Yeah, whatever the work I derived, this is the expansion process. But in air compressor, what process is taking place? Is it is expansion? Is the process is expansion? In air compressor, we need to do compression process, right? So what is the difference? Compression process, the direction is reversed. Compression means here 2 to 1 is taking place. During compression process, if you see, the pressure is increasing, volume is decreasing. Therefore, if you multiply with minus, you will get the compression work. Therefore, W during compression is equals to P2 V2 minus P1 V1 by N minus 1. This is the compression. Just in this, I multiplied with minus so that I'll get the compression work. This is required for me in order to proceed further. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, right. Now, come to our slide. Right, so this is I discussed yesterday itself. Let me recall quickly. So a compressor is a device which take a fixed quantity of the fluid that is usually swept volume, okay? And the same will be delivered at the required pressure, right? So it takes atmospheric air at the temperature 1 bar and room temperature, and it compresses it and delivers to the high pressure, and it stores in the vessel. Whenever we required, we can make use of the high pressure air. Okay, right. So here this is the compression process. Therefore, we need to supply some external work. Okay, we need to supply some external work. Therefore, we are supplying by using the prime mover, or we can use, say, engine also, some heat engine also we can use, right? Heat engine is the power producing device, right? Now, so heat engine or some electric motor can be used to compress the air compressor. Now, so here, what are the basic differences between pump and compressor, right? Now, so basically, if you see the fluids may be of two types, so that may be liquid or gases. So fluids can be broadly classified two categories, liquids as well as gases, right? So whereas liquids are incompressible, we cannot compress the liquid. So we can call it as incompressible fluids are liquid, and gases are compressible fluids. So gases are compressible fluids means what happened? It means the volume remains constant. Incompressible here, volume is changing, right? Now, so if you compress, what happened? The volume will decrease, pressure will increase. Whereas in case of liquids, they are incompressible. Okay, we cannot change the volume. So as the gases are compressible, therefore the compressor also reduces the volume of the gas due to the compressible. So the volume is going to decrease and its pressure increases, right? Whereas liquids are incompressible, there is no change in the volume, right? So therefore, in order to handle the liquids, pumps are used, and in order to handle the gases, compressors are used. Okay, and I already discussed the applications. Okay, so air conditioners in cars and homes, pneumatic devices, industrial purposes, paint industry, cleaning industry, right? Na? And these are even in turbos, in automobiles, we are using the air compressors. Okay, and I already discussed what is a positive displacement compressor. I am calling it as positive displacement because the fixed quantity of the air will be sucked during the suction stroke, and the same will be compressed and delivered at the required pressure. So therefore, we can call the reciprocating compressor as a positive displacement types of compressors, right? And coming to the classification, first one is the type of working. first classification I can say it is reciprocating compressor and rotary compressor based on the type of the working. And the second classification is based on the number of stages. I can call it as single stage air compressor, multi-stage air compressor. Means if we are using only one cylinder to increase the pressure, we can call it as a single stage air compressor. If I'm using more than one cylinder, the number of cylinders can be up to six. So the number of cylinders can be up to six. Therefore, if you want high pressures, if you want to increase the pressure to the higher value, it's not possible with the single stage. I'll explain in the coming slides why one stage is not sufficient, or it's not correct for increasing high pressure. The problems associated with the single stage we'll discuss. Then only we'll go for the multi-stage, right? If you want to raise the pressure higher value, then we'll go for the multi-stage. Means the number of cylinders are more than one. So we are compressing in more than one stage. Therefore, we are getting the required pressure. That is the second classification. And third one is based on the type of acting, that is single acting and double acting. So what is single acting and double acting? Single acting means if the working fluid, in case of air compressor, where the working fluid is the air, if the working fluid is in one side of the piston, is in contact with one side of the piston, I can call it as single acting air compressor. And if the working fluid is in contact with both sides of the piston, we can call it as double acting air compressor. So this is the broadly classified. So based on the working, we can call it as reciprocating as rotary. What is reciprocating? Due to the reciprocating motion of the piston inside the cylinder, the air is compressed. Whereas in case of rotary air compressor, so there will be rotor or vanes are there. So due to the rotary motion, right, the between the vanes and the casing, the air is compressed. It's not in our syllabus right now. Just know, due to the rotary motion, the air is compressed. Due to the reciprocating motion, the air is compressed. Whereas second classification is based on the number of stages, that is single stage and multi-stage, and based on the type of acting, it is single acting and double acting. I already discussed about single acting and double acting. So in order to get more clarity, I'll show you one more video. Okay, so just 1 minute only. Now you can see here, the piston is moving to and fro motion. Okay, when the piston is moving from left to right, you can see the blue colored is the suction. At the same time, right side, if you observed, there may be delivery. Now you can see this is the suction, this is the delivery. Again, this is the suction, and other side of the piston is the delivery. Means the working fluid, that is air, is in contact on both sides of the piston. So in case of double acting, so there will be two suction valves as well as two delivery valves, right? Now, so one side suction, other side delivery. So when this side is suction, other side it is delivery. This is the double acting air compressor. Even you can see in PV diagram, the blue colored line is the suction, and this is the compression till here. Then this is the discharge. Again, expansion, suction, compression till here. Then this is the discharge, right? So far we discussed only suction, compression, and discharge. There will be one more operation, that is the expansion. I'll discuss that one also. Is this video is clear? The same thing I explained yesterday. Double acting air compressor.
Yes, sir.
Right now. So you can see always the suction valve is located at the bottom side, and in first video it will be clear, and delivery valve is located on the top side of the cylinder head. This is the cylinder head. Okay, and you can see in the video also there are certain grooves over the piston. Did anyone observe? There will be grooves over the piston. Inside the grooves,
piston rings.
Inside the rings, inside the grooves, piston rings are there, right? So the main purpose of piston rings are, so here if you see bottom side, we are having lubricating oil. So bottom side we are having lubricating oil, at the top side we are having high pressure air, right? So the main purpose of these rings are, it won't allow the air to enter into the crankcase, or it won't allow the lubricating oil to enter into the combustion chamber. I can call it as a cylinder swept volume. Okay, means it will prevent the air to not to enter into the lubricating oil. At the same time, lubricating oil will also not enter into the cylinder. Okay, so that is a airtight casing, in order to make it as airtight casing. And so again, why we are using lubricating oil means wherever there is relative motion between the parts, there may be chances of friction. Due to the friction, heat will be generated. Due to that, wear and tear will take place, right? In order to reduce the friction means in order to reduce the wear and tear. So wherever relative motion, even if you see, this is the connecting rod and this is the crank. So connecting rod and crank are joined between crank pin. Even piston and connecting rod are joined with help of piston pin or wrist pin, right? So there will be relative motion because always the connecting rod oscillates. When connecting rod oscillates, there will be relative motion between piston and connecting rod and crank. And here we have bearings of the crankshaft, right? So all these places you need to lubricate. Thereby we can reduce the friction. We can take the heat, right? So due to the relative motion, heat will be generated. If we are in a position to dissipate the heat, no question of wear and tear. Otherwise, wear and tear will take place. We need to replace the parts within no time. Okay, so that is the main reason lubrication plays a major role in any engine. Okay, wherever there is a relative motion, we should give lubrication. We should supply sufficient lubricating oil, right? Then only it will work efficiently. Otherwise, due to friction, wear and tear will take place. Yeah, here you can see video also says the same thing. So this is the suction line. You can see here suction valve is located at the bottom and delivery valve is located at the top. Okay, so when the piston is moving from top to bottom, so vacuum will be created, thereby the air will be sucked into the cylinder. Again, when the piston is moving from BDC to TDC, the same air will be compressed. And once the pressure reaches to the required pressure or designed pressure, the delivery valve will be opened, thereby the air will be stored into the tank. This is the working. The same thing over here, right? So here timing, you remember, I'll explain in detail about. If I didn't explain about expansion so far, but here I can see here, it's not, the TDC is not here. The TDC means the piston is starting from here instead of here. This volume is called clearance volume. This volume is called clearance volume. So why clearance is required? Is it is required or not? We will discuss, right? So always clearance is required for any type of engine, any type of reciprocating engine, that may be air compressor or IC engine. Clearance is must and should, right? Means if clearance is not there, the main problem is, what is this one? This is called piston head and this is called cylinder head. Okay, this is the cylinder head and this is the piston head. Can you see my screen, all of you?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Whenever there is no clearance, what will happen? Always the piston reciprocates inside the cylinder. Means for every revolution of the crank, for every one revolution of crank, there will be two strokes of the piston. Right now? So means every time when the piston is moving up and down, if it is touching with the cylinder head, whenever let us say we are allowed to touch the piston with the cylinder, so what will happen due to the contact between the piston and cylinder head, there will be friction between the piston and cylinder head. So due to that, heat will be generated, wear and tear will take place. That is the one reason why we are allowing the clearance. If there is no clearance, every time when the crank rotates, the piston reciprocates inside the cylinder. So due to that, the piston head is in contact with cylinder head for every one revolution of the crank. So due to that, heat will be generated. Due to the friction, heat will be generated. That is the first reason. Second reason is, due to the design of the valves, as I told, suction valve is located at the bottom of the piston cylinder head and exhaust delivery valve is located at the top. You can see suction valve is located at the bottom and delivery valve is located at the top. So this valve design does not allow the piston to touch the cylinder head for every time. These are the two reasons why there is clearance between the piston and cylinder. Even the IC engine also same concept. Why there is clearance between the piston and cylinder? First reason is, if there is no clearance, every revolution of the crank, the piston head touches the cylinder head. Due to this, what will happen? Wear and tear will take place due to the friction. Heat will be generated, wear and tear takes place. That is the first reason why we are providing clearance. Second reason is, the design of the valves does not allow the piston to touch the cylinder. So that is the reason there is clearance. Now, if there is clearance between the piston and cylinder, what happens to the air compressor? We will discuss in the coming slides. Now it is clear why clearance is required?
Yes.
Right. Now at this instant of time, I want, yeah, tell me.
Sir,
Can you speak louder? Your voice is not continuous. It's fluctuating.
Sorry, doubt, sir.
Can you come again?
Sir, ek doubt hai, sir.
Yeah, please tell me.
सेक्शन और सेक्शन के टाइम पे सर जो वॉल्व ओपन होता है ना वो कंप्रेशन वेल कंप्रेशन डजंट दैट एयर गो बैक थ्रू सेक्शन वॉल
या आई विल टेल यू
इज देयर एनी चांस
या दैट्स व्हाट आई विल टेल यू Right. So let us say like this, right? Suction valve is located at the bottom side and exhaust valve is located at the top side, right? Now, so your doubt is, let us say when the crank is rotating, so due to that, what will happen? The piston will reciprocates inside the cylinder. Means, let us say, when the piston is moving from TDC to BDC, what is happening, right? So, initially, both the valves are in closed position. This inlet valve and delivery valve, both are in closed position, and the piston is moving downward direction. So, during that time, what will be there? Here, vacuum will be created. So, due to that, due to the pressure difference, here we are having higher pressure. Here we are having lower pressure, right? So, thereby, this valve will open and it will suck the air from the atmosphere. Okay. Now, let us say, now at this instant of time, the piston is at the bottom dead center. Now the piston is at the bottom dead center, right? So immediately when the piston starts moving BDC to TDC, the inlet valve will not closed immediately, right? So when the unit crosses certain portion, certain percentage of the stroke, what will happen automatically? The pressure rises, right? So once the pressure rises, volume will decrease. That air will push this wall. You can see the design of the wall. So this air will push this wall. Thereby, this wall will be closed. Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Am I answered your question?
Yes, sir.
Right? But means when the piston is moving from BDC.
Till the pressure is. Till the pressure is, high from the outside atmosphere. There might be a chance of going some air out. Through suction valve, sir.
Yeah, little bit air can escape, but it's not possible because the valve will be like a plate one. It's like plate actually. Okay. So once when the piston is at BDC, can you tell me what is the pressure of air inside the cylinder? Atmosphere, right? Now, right? So here the pressure is atmosphere, outside the pressure is also atmosphere. There is no question of escaping air through the inlet valve because both the pressures are same, right? Again, during the movement of the piston upward direction, right? So the pressure will be increased, volume will be decreased, thereby the valve will be closed. Further compression, what will happen? Once the desired pressure reaches, automatically this delivery valve will be pushed outward direction. It designed like that, in such a way, it is easy to open this fashion, right? During suction stroke, it will not open because the valve design is like that. Because it is located at the top. Okay, now? Okay. Am I clear? Right, now. Now here I'll explain. I want this diagram. Now I'll explain PV diagram without clearance. I'm assuming without clearance, how the PV diagram? Without clearance, the PV diagram of air compressor. So this PV diagram is ideal case. Ideal PV diagram, or I can call it as theoretical PV diagram. ideal or theoretical PV diagram. Right. On x-axis, I am taking volume. Y-axis, I am taking pressure. Okay. Y-axis, I am taking pressure right now. So let us assume this is the atmospheric line, pressure line, P atmosphere. And this is my discharge line, P discharge or P delivery. I want to increase the pressure from, this is my suction line and this is my discharge line, right? Now, so here I can say, now this is equals to top dead center. And this is nothing but bottom dead center. From here to here, what can I call? Anyone please answer me. What is the distance between TDC to BDC?
Swept length.
And the volume corresponding is a swept volume, not swept volume. It is total volume of the cylinder. Right now, the volume corresponding to TDC to BDC is swept to total volume. V total is equals to pi by 4 into area. Pi by 4 d square multiplied by the stroke length gives the total volume of the cylinder. Okay. Now, so once the piston is moving from TDC to BDC, now we can see. When the piston is moving from TDC to BDC, let us say 0.4, 0.1. What is this operation?
Constant pressure.
Suction.
Constant pressure suction means the air will enter into the air compressor at atmospheric condition, right? Now, so let us say at 0.1, it reaches BDC, right? Now, at 0.1, it reaches BDC. Now, the return stroke of the piston, what is the operation it is starting? The return stroke is the compression, right? Now, the return stroke is the compression. Now, this compression, now suction is taking place at constant pressure. Try to understand this one. So, this line is horizontal line, means suction is taking place at constant pressure. But now, the during the return stroke of the piston, it is a compression. This compression can follow any of the processes I discussed in the starting of this class. So, the compression may be either adiabatic compression or polytropic compression, or isothermal compression, right? Now, the compression may be any of these three. The compression may be any of these three. Okay. Now, let us assume. Where is my figure? Yeah. Let us assume the compression is following according to the polytropic process, right? Now, one second. Right. So this is 1, 2, 2. This is the compression process. So during the compression process, what happens to volume? The volume is decreased from 1, 2, 2. Yes or no? The volume is decreased from 1, 2, 2. At the same time, pressure is increased from suction pressure to the delivery pressure. The P2 is the delivery pressure. Now at point two, see, at point two, now the delivery valve opens. Agree? At point 4, suction valve opens, right? So after point 1, the suction valve closes. Till further compression, the delivery valve will opens. Now, the discharge of the air will take place at constant pressure. Now, 2 to 3 process, it is the discharge or delivery. Right? No? Means now at the end of the discharge, the piston again reaches top dead center, again the cycle will repeat. Suction, compression, discharge. Suction, compression, discharge. This is the theoretical or ideal PV diagram. But actual case, it's not. I'll discuss later. Is this clear PV diagram?
Yes, sir.
Right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. This compression may be either isothermal compression or adiabatic compression or polytropic compression. The compression may be either any of these three. We will discuss one by one, right? So if the compression follows isothermal, what is the work done? If the compression follows adiabatic process, what is the work done? And if it follows polytropic, what is the work done? And if you are recalling the previous semester, what is the area under PV diagram? Very, very important. I discussed that area under PV diagram gives. Very good, very good. The area under PV diagram gives the work done. Means in order to calculate how much amount of work required in order to take place this compression process. If I am able to calculate the area under this PV diagram, this area is equivalent to the work required to compress the air. Got the point? So why I'm stressing now means, so I have the PV diagram. Okay, if you are able to calculate the area under this PV diagram, that is nothing but the work required to compress the air. Okay, and similarly, we know that the area under TS diagram gives
heat supply.
Heat.
Very good. Heat flow. Area under TS diagram is gives the heat flow that may be added or rejected from the system. Okay, na? Right. Now what I will do? Now I will explain. What is the, if clearance volume exists, what happens to the PV diagram? So tomorrow I'll discuss the derivation and everything, because once just now I discussed without clearance. If clearance exists, what is happening? Okay, PV diagram with clearance volume. CV is the clearance volume. Okay, now, so can you tell me why we clearance is required?
To avoid friction.
Very good. To avoid friction and the valve design will not permit to touch the piston head with the cylinder head every time. So therefore, there will be always certain gap between the piston head and cylinder head, that is called clearance. Suction valve, discharge valve. This is the piston. Connecting rod, and this is the crank. Okay, now let us say this is the extreme point, right? It's not TDC, is now this is the TDC because of the clearance, and this is the BDC, let us assume. Now this distance from piston cylinder head to the TDC is the VC. What is VC?
Clearance volume,
right? Now we will see, in the presence of clearance volume, what happens to the PV diagram, right? Now we know that why clearance is required. Now due to the presence of clearance, what is happening, we will see. Now this is suction pressure, that is P atmosphere, and this is the discharge pressure, P delivery. We discharge or delivery, right? Now, so here is 1 to 2. Sorry, this is 0.4. Let us say 4 to 1. What is happening? First, we will discuss without clearance. Then, over that, I'll write with clearance. What are the changes? Suction. 1 to 2 compression, 2 to 3 discharge. This is without clearance, right? Now due to the clearance, what is happening here? Is there any change in the compression? No, there is no change in the compression. Only there will be change in the delivery, right? Now, so try to understand this figure. Suction is completed, compression, then delivery. So at the end of the delivery, yeah, before this, now I have one question. If there is no clearance, can you hear me? Anyone?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes,
if there is no clearance, at the end of the discharge, is there any air present within the cylinder?
No, sir.
No, right? No? If there is no clearance, the piston head will touches the cylinder head. Therefore, whatever the quantity of air present within the cylinder, 100% it will be removed from the cylinder. But due to the presence of clearance, there will be always certain amount of air will be present between the piston head and cylinder head, and that is occupied by the clearance volume. Mean this much volume of air. Yes, please mute your mics. This much. Yes, mute your mic, please. Somebody unmuted. Right. So due to the clearance, at the end of the discharge, this is the volume of air that will be remains within the cylinder. Now, can you tell me what is the state of that air at the end of the discharge? Anyone, what is the state of air at that point?
Compressed.
means high pressure, yes or no?
High pressure.
High pressure air. Okay, right? Now, therefore, now due to the clearance, let us say the point 3 will be shifted to here. Right? So, means the discharge will be continuous till 3. At this point 3, the position of air will be high pressured air. Therefore, after this next, what strokes will start? After discharge, suction. Again, suction has to start. Means during the suction, what will happen? The piston will move from TDC to BDC. Therefore, what will happen? The piston will move downward direction. So I can call this process as expansion or not. Now, during this process, now 3 to 4, what happens to the pressure?
Decreases.
Right, now, right? So this process continues till the pressure reaches to atmospheric pressure. This process continues till the pressure reaches to atmospheric pressure, right? Now I'm calling this 3 to 4 as expansion, and this is the compression, this is the suction, and this is the discharge. Now tell me, what happened with the clearance to the PV diagram by comparing without clearance? The first one will be, when there is no clearance, the volume, swept volume is equals to total volume, agree? When,
yes sir,
when VC is equals to 0, V1 means from here to here, V1 is equals to VS when VC is 0. Okay, and due to the clearance, what is happening now? What is this volume, this dot, this line corresponding to? This volume is equals to clearance volume VC. Volume corresponding to point 3 here. Okay. Therefore,
yes, sir.
Yeah, swept volume is equals to V1 minus VC. Agree? Means from the total volume, V1 is the total volume. This is the total volume. So total volume is equals to swept volume when clearance is 0. Total volume is equals to swept volume when clearance is 0. Due to the presence of clearance, the total the swept volume is equals to total volume minus clearance volume. But it's not taking place practically. Now, is actual suction starts at this point? Please look at the figure. Is where suction starts actually, is at this point or at this point?
At 4.
It is taking place at 4, but according to theory, it should start at 3, yes or no?
Yes, sir.
But why this much amount of air is less? Because the air already, due to the presence of clearance, at the end of the discharge, there will be certain air will be present inside the compressor, and that too under high pressure. So due to the high pressure, what will happen? The suction valve will not open because the pressure is greater than the atmospheric pressure inside the cylinder. So first the pressure of air should drops to atmosphere. First we should decrease the pressure of air present within the cylinder to the atmosphere. Then only the inlet valve will open. Therefore, we are giving certain time to the air to expand. Thereby, the pressure is decreased to the atmosphere. Then the inlet valve will open, right? So therefore, instead of V1 minus VC, now the swept volume is V1 minus V4. We can call it as effective swept volume. Total volume is V1. Swept volume is V1 minus V3, V1 minus VC. But effective swept volume is V1 minus V4. Why effective swept volume came into exist? Because of the expansion of the high pressured air within the cylinder at the end of the discharge stroke. In order to take place the suction, first the pressure inside the cylinder should be decreased to the atmosphere. Therefore, the actual suction starts at point 4. Therefore, the V1 minus V4 is called effective swept volume. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Right. Right. Now. Okay. Some of the terminologies we'll discuss. Okay. Right. So, just 5 minutes. Compression ratio. Compression ratio is defined as volume at the start of the compression to the volume at the end of the compression, right? Now, so if you see, so this is the, let us say, a piston is at the bottom dead center, so therefore suction is completed, right? So this is the volume within the cylinder before start of the compression, and let us say this is the end of the compression, therefore this is the volume left at the end of the compression. So volume before start of compression to the volume at the end of the compression is called as compression ratio, and this value is always greater than 1, the compression ratio. And here we can define one more quantity, pressure ratio. Pressure ratio is defined as the ratio of delivery pressure to the suction pressure. The ratio of delivery pressure to the suction pressure is called pressure ratio. This value is also greater than 1 always, because the delivery pressure is always greater than the suction pressure, right? And compressor capacity. Compressor capacity is nothing but the quantity of air it can be delivered actually per minute or per second. Always volume will be in terms of meter cube only. The actual quantity of air delivered in terms of meter cube per minute or meter cube per second, that is called its capacity. And free air delivery is also similar to compressor capacity, provided when it is brought to the inlet condition. Inlet condition is 1 bar NTP condition, 1 bar and 15 degrees centigrade. It is the volume of air delivered by the compressor under the compressor intake conditions, that is temperature and pressure. Intake conditions are 1 bar and 15 degree centigrade. I'll explain in detail about free air delivery while solving problems. Free air delivery is the volume, both are similar, compressor capacity and free air delivery. But here free air delivery is the conditions are brought to inlet condition. Let us, I'll give one example here. Let us say the compressor is delivering, let us say P is equals to 10 bar and V is equals to some 20 meter cube per minute, and temperature is equals to, let us say, 30 degrees centigrade. Now, if you want to calculate free air delivery, right? So free air delivery, according to equation of state, we know that PV equal to MRT, M and mass flow rate is always constant throughout the process, and R is the gas constant, it is also constant. PV by T is equals to constant. So therefore, I can write, so for free air FAD conditions, I am taking ambient, PA VA by TA is equals to, let us say, you can take P1, V1, T1. So P1, V1 by T1. In this one, P1 value is known, V1 is known, T1 is known, and T ambient is 15 degree, P ambient is 1 bar, nothing but 1.013 kilopascal, and you can calculate VA, where VA is called FAD of that particular compressor. VA means actual volume of air delivered when it is brought to the inlet condition. Inlet condition in the sense 1 bar and 15 degree centigrade. So the corresponding volume is called free air delivery. The free air delivery is used to compare the air compressors. That's it. It is used to compare the air compressors. And swept volume is nothing but it is a volume displaced, that is equals to when the piston is moving from top dead center to bottom dead center, that is 5 by 4 D square into L. That gives the swept volume. And clearance volume is the volume left between the piston head and cylinder head. That is the clearance volume. There is always a gap between the piston head and cylinder head. Okay, that volume is called clearance volume. If you subtract clearance volume from the total volume, you will get the swept volume. Okay, and volumetric efficiency is nothing but actual volume to the swept volume. V actual to the V swept, that gives the volumetric efficiency, actual volume to the swept volume. And isothermal efficiency is defined as the ratio of isothermal power to the indicated power, or isothermal work to the actual work. Isothermal to the actual, that is the isothermal efficiency. So I can explain here. So let us say here we have PV diagram, suction, compression, right? So here, in order to calculate the isothermal efficiency, let us say actually it is following polytropic process. Actually it is following polytropic process. Means you need to calculate the work done by assuming the process is following isothermally, and we need to calculate the work done by assuming the actual process that is given as polytropic. Then the ratio gives the isothermal efficiency, right? Na? Then mechanical efficiency is nothing but the ratio of indicated power to the shaft power. Indicated power to the shaft power gives the mechanical efficiency, and the product of isothermal efficiency and mechanical efficiency is called overall efficiency. The product of isothermal and mechanical efficiency, if you multiply these two, right, so what will happen? So you will get it, the isothermal power to the shaft power. So isothermal power to the shaft power, right? Now, so you will get the overall efficiency. These are the terminologies related to the air compressor. In next class, we will derive the equations for work done by considering clearance volume and by neglecting clearance volume. Now, can anyone tell me, in this figure, did we considered clearance or neglected clearance?
Neglected.
Right. First, we will consider without clearance. Then we will do equations by considering clearance. Okay, na? Right. So with this, we'll stop today's class.